It's an honor to speak with you today, and a special honor to participate in the inaugural McKenna Leadership Academy. Sean McKenna and I are from the same home chapter, as Ryan mentioned, Maine Alpha, and even though he preceded me by more than two decades, he was a close friend and mentor from the time that we first met 17 years ago until his untimely passing last June. Sean McKenna was a stand-up hero. Today's also a reminder of how quickly time flies. It feels like just yesterday I was in your seat attending Carlson Leadership Academy for the first time. Sean McKenna always talked about his first conclave as the experience that opened his eyes to SIGEP being something bigger than his home chapter. For many of you, this weekend will hopefully be a similar experience. This organization and its 300,000 lifetime members span all walks of life and diversity of careers. As Ryan also said, I was a chapter officer, like many of you are or will be. What he didn't say is that I made a lot of mistakes. Fortunately, I had mentors like Brother McKenna to call or email after stepping into, or in some cases, creating a mess. Distilling various missteps and some successes as an undergraduate chapter officer and early career professional, there are three lessons I wanted to share with you today. One is meet people where they are. Two is deal with your problems early. And third, keep an open mind. So the first lesson, meet people where they are. This was one of Sean McKenna's true skills. I have no doubt that for each of you, there are brothers in your chapter who are different than you are. Religious versus non-religious, reserved versus outgoing, different nationalities and customs, different family backgrounds, from limited means or perhaps wealthy. One of my biggest mistakes as a young chapter leader was to assume that others saw the world the way I did. I transposed my values and beliefs onto them and would get frustrated when they didn't share the same priorities or speak or act the same way I did. This applied to a lot of different situations and decisions, from what our target GPA should be to what type of social and philanthropic events we would pursue. So I have an example. I was a big proponent of dressing up for Monday night chapter meetings, and I still am. The logic for it is straightforward. The chapter would usually only get together once a week. It was an event we took seriously, and wearing a shirt and tie was a signal internally and externally that we were doing something important. With this line of reasoning, I had convinced the rest of the executive officers of the chapter and a majority of the chapter brothers that dressing up every Monday night would be one of our rules. And in fact, the chapter voted that a collared shirt and tie would be required attire at Monday night meetings. But not everyone was happy about the decision. At the very next meeting after the vote, one of the dissenting brothers showed up with a green polo shirt buttoned to the top, adorned with a brown silk necktie. He looked ridiculous, but was technically in compliance with the rules passed by the chapter the preceding week. Everyone had a good laugh at his appearance, and in fact, he was technically in compliance with the rules, but I was pissed off. Rather than join in laughing and letting go, who would want to dress like that, and who wasn't even comfortable, I approached him after the meeting and told him what I thought of him mocking the standards that our chapter had agreed to. And of course, my lecturing only motivated him to attend the next dozen chapter meetings in the same attire. Whereas if instead I acknowledged that he wasn't happy about the rule and that he was clever for both complying with it and also calling out the fact that simply wearing a shirt and tie does not necessarily make someone well-dressed, I have no doubt the outcome would have been different. Lesson two, deal with your problems early. At the start of my term as a chapter president, I learned various university-made fraternities were collecting road signs as chapter house decorations, and that several of my brothers were doing so as well. And as crazy as it might sound, there's not much to do in Maine in the winter sometimes, so I guess it's something they chose to do. Sensing the risks involved, I quickly built consensus with the chapter officers that this activity was something we couldn't participate in. Even though it seemed like no one specific was hurt by a missing street sign, the activity represented inconsistent values for the fraternity's ideals. So, after getting the chapter officers on board, we didn't hold a vote. We simply told the chapter that it was an ABC position that stolen property couldn't be in the chapter house, road signs for stolen property, and we implemented the policy. Fortunately, only a few brothers were upset that they went along with the decision. Fast forward a couple of months, there was a tragic fire at the University of Maine Sigma Alpha Epsilon house. The fire department responded, put out the blaze, but there was damage to the point of making the house unlivable for the semester. There was immediately an outcry of support for SAE, and the university and town rallied. They found places for all the displaced brothers, alternative housing. But then reports came in that there were more than 50 road signs found in the SAE chapter house, including a stolen stop sign. The outpouring of support from the community quickly became a major campus outrage and controversy. And instead of receiving continued support, the SAE chapter faced disciplinary sanctions, and the town and fire department embarked on fire inspections to look for road signs in the other chapter houses. Seeking to limit the crisis, the dean of students declared an amnesty on the fraternities, and he visited each house with a truck from facilities management, and they collected road signs. When he got to SIGA, he was surprised to learn that we had none in our house. In fact, we learned later that we were the only fraternity that did not need to turn in any road signs as part of the amnesty program. As you can imagine, our standing in the eyes of the dean rose substantially. Being in a fraternity will expose you to diversity of views and opinions. One of the areas I failed early in my chapter leadership experience was to build greater understanding with my chapter brothers, particularly those who came from different backgrounds. Conflict for us revolved around the role of alcohol in the chapter house and at chapter events. 15 years ago, as an undergraduate, I was a vociferous advocate that our chapter should be dry. Even though most of our chapter is under 21, this was, of course, a source of controversy. And in hindsight, particularly for 15 years ago, I probably dug in my heels too hard and alienated many good men who shared the same overarching ideals of virtue, diligence, and brotherly love, but had a modestly different vision of what the chapter should be. Without making judgment, I understand your chapters are at various levels of implementation of the historic legislation passed at Conclave last August. For each person here, whether they be from chapters that are completely dry or chapters that attend bar every weekend, hopefully not, I would encourage you to keep an open mind. Organizations with many different orientations can be successful. The people in them are rarely 100% good or 100% bad, and the right way of conducting business yesterday may not work in business today. Sean McKenna knew this implicitly. He always asked others what they thought, if there was a better way to run a process or an event, or what could be done to improve. When sincere, the act of soliciting others' views will build both trust and be a useful source of ideas for improvement. Looking back on my SIGEP experience as an undergraduate, I'm in awe of how well it prepared me for leadership in corporate finance. Negotiating across the table from bondholders, bank lenders, or an acquisition partner, I always look for a way to meet my counterparty where they are before conveying the needs of my client. It's also standard advice when I encounter clients in financial distress that they need to address their problems as early as possible. Doing so only makes the problems worse. And more than once, I've benefited from keeping an open mind. There's no monopoly on wisdom, and there have been creative transaction ideas that have come from teammates, clients, mentors, negotiating partners, and others. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today. I'm inspired by the quality and character of the men I've met this weekend, and I think our beloved fraternity's best days lay ahead. Thank you.